Not so long after he died, one of the great philosophers of the 1990s released a song called More Money, More Problems. But is that right? Should it be More Money, Less Problems? Well, the book that I'm discussing with its translator for this episode might help you arrive at an answer to that question. The book is Graft, the translator is James Trapp, and I'm Angus Stewart, and you're listening to the Translated Chinese Fiction Podcast. Before we leap ahead to that discussion, I'm going to serve you up three items in the TrChFic news, the translated Chinese fiction news. The first news item is a bit of a callback to a past episode. You may remember that I talked to the translator Mei Huang about her translation of Qiu Changting's Raining Zebra Finches, and at the time when we discussed that story, it was on its way to publication, and now it is published. Published in English translation in the Massachusetts Review. I believe to read the story, you've got to purchase all of the latest issue of the Massachusetts Review, so you can go do that on their website. That is linked to in the show description, the show notes, under news items. You'll see it right there. The second news item is a book club discussion. It was the online Confucius Institute in the UK's Open University. Not that recently, March 24th, they held an event on Jiapinghua's Backflow River, as translated by Nikki Harmon, and the discussion had no less than four translators present. There as facilitators was Nikki herself and Emily Jones, and there were two other gentlemen translators there as well, Dylan Levi-King and Nick Stember. So I have not watched this one, but it is there to stream. You can watch a recording of discussion at the page linked to in the show notes, and there's a transcript as well. You can get to that through the same page. So if that sounds up your alley, if you are a Jiapinghua head, a Pinghua head, Jia head, a Jia head, there we go. If you're a Jia head, then go check that one out. Okay, third item, this is a pointer to my rivals, the Chinese Literature Podcast. I believe this one was Lee Moore flying solo. I think possibly he's flying completely solo now on the show, but in any case, his episode was on poetry from sex workers in Dalian, the northern Chinese city. So something a little bit different, I guess. He said in the description, because again, I've not actually listened to this, that he uses the poem to tackle issues of gender in China. It's just about 14 minutes long, and as you might have guessed, there's some explicit language. So if you're looking for something a bit different, let's say, and that's piqued your interest, go check it out, go listen to it. But do bear in mind, of course, that for every episode of the Chinese Literature Podcast that you stream or download, you need to stream or download five of mine. It's just the rules, I'm sorry, but it is what it is. That is all for the TrChFic news, so I will zip my mouth, and I will let you guys enjoy my interview with James discussing the mighty graft. So let's get grafty. And let's never say let's get grafty again. That wasn't good. Okay, enjoy the interview. So on the show, I have James Trapp, the translator of a book called Graft. So James, wonderful to have you here. We've spoken before via the medium of Zoom, but this is your first time on the show. So would you like to tell the listeners a little bit about yourself?
Yes, well, good evening, and yeah, pleasure to be here. Where to begin? Well, what I am now is essentially a full-time freelance translator of primarily contemporary Chinese fiction. It's a career I've come into quite late in life and accidentally. Previously, I've been, well, going back, I took my degree in Chinese a long time ago at SOAS, School of Oriental and African Studies at London University. I graduated in 1981. And subsequently, I covered quite a lot of ground in various ways, waiting for China to become mainstream in the West, as it were. So most recently and relevantly, I've taught Mandarin in primary and secondary school settings, mainly cool. As after school clubs. This was at the beginning when I used to run after school clubs. And then I got involved with a company called Bamboo Learning. And with them, I co-authored schemes of work for primary Mandarin for the last Labour administration, which gives you an idea of how long ago that was. Oh. Sadly, we're about two-thirds complete. And then with the change of regime, the entire project was just shelved. A huge, Yeah, a great waste of time and everyone's money. Subsequently, I worked at the British Museum in the education department. I was China education manager there. I got that job on the back of the big First Emperor Terracotta Army exhibition there. I was initially hired to write all the educational material for that. And at that point, there was a great enthusiasm for trying to develop Chinese provision at the museum. The then director, Neil McGregor, was all gung-ho about it, but somehow it all just, as these things do, just petered out. But I had a very supportive boss in the education department who kept me on for as long as he could, trying to build up the provision at the museum. But you can't create a demand where there isn't one. And since China doesn't figure on the English curriculum anywhere, or in very few places, and school visits to museums are dictated by curriculum demands. So it didn't really ever take off. And I left there just having just done most of the work on the big Ming exhibition, which must have been about 7 years ago. It was a fabulous exhibition of the Ming Dynasty. And then went to work at the Confucius Institute at the Institute of Education, University of London, where I was leading a five-year project to try and develop primary school Mandarin on the back of the government's ill-fated primary MFL initiative, which was actually turned out to be pretty much of a joke. But I did. I developed more materials there, concentrating as far as I could on combining culture and language, because my one of my underlying beliefs about teaching Chinese is that you need to teach as much about the country and the culture and the history as you do the language, because the two work so intimately together, and there's really little point in trying to learn a language in isolation. So that's always been my kind of shtick in education. That project ended and wasn't refinanced, but at which point I happened to meet a chance meeting at the Frankfurt Book Fair with one of the directors of Alan Charles Asia Publishing, Ying Matheson, who asked me if I fancied having a go at translating a novel that they had. I didn't know at the time that I think it had been turned down by about three other translators because of its length and complexity. And I, in my gung-ho manner, said, yes, I'll give it a go. Thoroughly enjoyed it. That was Sun Sidajuan, Wang Hongjia, the story of the Song Dynasty judge come crime scene investigator Sun Tzu. So it was early Chinese CSI. Fascinating book, great book. Yeah. And then it just went on from there, and I've been in pretty much permanent employment translating novels ever since.
The anecdotes about the sort of house of sand, that is not a phrase, the sandy foundation, the slippery, nope, I've completely blown that. What do you call that? Unfirm.
I know there's a phrase that we're now both for something before, and I can't think what it is. The shifting sands of education.
Shifting sands. That's it. Yeah, the shifting sands of government, money and the government.
Well, I mean, not just that, but also the total lack of understanding of the importance of teaching modern foreign languages from an early age as possible. It's just something that for some reason the British don't get, or the English in particular, just don't get. And it's a great shame, because it has, you know, learning any foreign language has a huge amount to offer. Chinese, more than most. And the earlier you start, the easier it is, because kids don't ask stupid questions about languages. They accept that this is another way of saying something, and they get on with it. Whereas once you get to about the age of 13, 14, and then adults, they're determined to ask, oh, why does it do this? Why doesn't it do that? You don't need to know. This is how it, anyway. But no, the English attitude to teaching modern foreign languages is a total disgrace.
Right.
I'll leave it at that.
Right. Tell us what you really feel. I could send us charging straight into the more about sort of the slippery world of money, government, rise and fall. I'll just share a quick anecdote. I may have shared it on the show before, but new listeners won't have heard it. My little sister, who is in her mid and later teens now, when she was in primary school, there was talk of the school introducing Mandarin, potentially. It was up against two competitors, and they were Spanish and Urdu. Mm. And all, I guess they all had different sorts of rationales. Spanish was in there, I guess, because it's close, I suppose it's close-ish to English. It's a Western European language. And it's spoken by a large part of the world, thanks to South America. Mandarin, because, you know, it's the supposedly the big up-and-comer. If you want to engage with China, Mandarin's the language to learn. And then Urdu, it's almost like the opposite. It's the local, because every class will have, well, no, I don't know about every class, but lots of the kids at the school are from kids, they're from families with a Pakistani background, and maybe their parents or grandparents or whoever have much better Urdu than they do English. So they were all competing, and I don't really know what the outcome was. Possibly the outcome was none of it was, none of it went ahead.
Most likely it wasn't implemented, mainly because they would have had no money to implement it.
Just
to add another level of anecdotal idiocy, when this government's, well, it wasn't this government, who was on the throne at the time, Cameron, I suppose, and Michael Gove was Education Secretary, they named six target languages, six for primary MFL. Two of those were Latin and Greek. So, you know, I think that's all you need to know.
Yes. That's the old school Conservative Party. It's not even like the Thatcherite Conservative Party. Anyway, speaking of politics, the party, money, we're talking about a book called Graft, and it is basically about two guys who rise up through the world of sort of the muddy world of the Chinese state and the Chinese business. They have a, maybe as one might expect in a novel about people engaging in corruption, a rise and a fall. That's a really, really basic summary. But I wonder, as the translator, do you have an elevator pitch for Li Peifu's Graft?
Yes, it taps into one of the main things that everybody in the West thinks they know about China, which is that it's built on corruption.
Yeah.
And that this gives and also it kind of destroys the preconception that corruption is something that's not talked about in China. Everything in this book is absolutely out in the open. It's actually based on real life events. Without wanting to give too much away, it ends with the execution of a deputy governor of a province in the Yellow River Valley in the Central Plains. And this is for the murder of his second wife. And this is actually based on fact. And corruption novels are a distinct genre in China. This is, I think, one of the best, because actually it shows you the mechanisms of behind what we call corruption, but which the Chinese view more benignly, perhaps. There's a splendid Chinese term, Guanxi connections, which can cover a whole load of things. But I think its most saleable point, its most readable aspect, is the way it plunges you into areas of Chinese society which are essentially closed to most Westerners. We're in a provincial town, not in one of the big cities. We're in a provincial capital and out in the countryside. And it covers the tensions that existed at this particularly fraught time, because we're in the 1980s when China's just opened up and everything. I was visiting, sorry, this is not an elevator pitch anymore, but there we go.
We've left the elevator, now we're on the top floor and we can enjoy the view.
We're on the top floor, yes. Its selling point is that it takes you into areas of Chinese society that most Westerners know nothing about, and throws a light on the murkier internal workings of Chinese society.
Right. I thought your point about how it takes something your average Westerner thinks they know about China, that it's corrupt, and it also undercuts or subverts that by, well, one, revealing that this book is, you know, it's publishable and it's not beyond the pale for China's censors. I was also thinking, I think in the assumption that China must be corrupt, that maybe a lot of Westerners have, I think it's a simple and not unjustified line of thinking that, oh, it's a communist, authoritarian, state, and that means it's corrupt. So the logic would go, the more communist it is, the more corrupt it must be. But I think this novel, I don't know if it really tells you this, but we can see how corruption is maybe more just about the particular circumstances any state is in, because one of the specters, if you like, that's haunting this book is the recent past, the Mao era, which for all its terrible failings, massive financial corruption wasn't really one of them. It was a time which did have a moral code. Say what you like about the moral code, but it had one, and corruption wasn't endemic in Chinese society. It was, I have read a book about this, a book by Jeffrey Kinkley on, I think it's Crime and Anti-Corruption Fiction, I forget the name, but that one kind of fleshed out what I already roughly knew, that corruption in the PRC was sort of, it really got the ball got rolling during the 80s, during the market reforms, if I'm right, bloomed, was in full swing in the 90s and I think the 2000s, and now it's with a sort of return of authoritarianism that it's being brought to heel a bit. Not to say authoritarianism is great, but yeah, that's the sort of...
Well, I mean, it's clear because, you know, China was in notoriously, it ran on corruption in the dynastic period, certainly in the Qing dynasty, towards the end of the Qing dynasty and into the Republican period. And as you said, it was the introduction of communism that temporarily, at least, seemed to stem that almost inevitable tide. But once the gates were open to Western style capitalism, in kind of one of the immediate imports, it was a return to the old ways in a new context.
Right. So, yes.
I mean, it corruption has been endemic in China for millennia, as far as one can tell.
Yes, it's wrong of me to exclude everything that came before the communist revolution. That's silly of me.
But certainly it as far as we know, corruption was, I mean, I'm not an expert on corruption in the Mao period, but certainly I think you're right that it was minimal, presumably because the penalties were severe, and also the opportunities presumably were limited. Though, as you say, as soon as constraints went, I mean, I'm currently working on I seem to have made a speciality out of corruption novels, because I'm working on my third one at the moment, which is set in the early 2000s in a state-owned enterprise, a big energy conglomerate in North China, and the levels of corruption and the amounts of money involved in that are mind-blowing. It does seem to be. I mean, I presume. I mean, when corruption is endemic in most societies, where money buys you what you want.
For sure, yeah. No, I'm not accusing anyone of corruption here, but in my previous job, I was in a pharma trade magazine, so I was learning all about the lots of aspects of the pharma industry, and all sorts of things about the science are inconceivable and amazing to me, a humanities graduate, but also the sums of money that were involved in like funding rounds or purchases of, IP from one company to another. Some of them were like, £1 million. Okay, that's a large house, or $1 million, actually. All the money's measured in dollars. But others would be like $300 billion.
Yeah.
And it'd be like, okay, if you skimmed off 0.1% from $300 billion, you'd still be doing pretty good.
Yeah.
Like, so yeah, the bigger the pot, and then the smaller cut you need to take.
Similar sums of money are being talked about in the novel that I'm talking about at the moment, sort of ¥1.5 billion commission fees being paid and things like, it's just crazy. But there we are.
Yeah. Yeah. It sort of becomes unpinned from real value and things we can conceptualize with concrete, things that we can pin to material objects that we'd be using the money to buy. I realize I'm getting worryingly abstract, so I'll take us to the more sort of concrete side of the book that we can begin discussing characters, moral problems, and the plot. So I guess that's a bit of a sandwich, because moral problems aren't, that's more abstract. But anyway, I'll introduce our two main characters. We've got Li
Dilin. Yeah, you say two. I'm interested to see who you think two main characters are.
Okay. Well, I'll throw you a softball here. I'll name two, and then you can say, "Naha, you've forgotten the others." But yeah, I would say the two front running main, I don't know, our two initial protagonists anyway are Lidolin and now what is he called?
Ding.
Leo Jinding. That's right, and it's sort of a master and apprentice style deal. I guess it's like a Obi-Wan and Anakin deal
Well,
because
yeah, I was thinking about that because it's a little mysterious because it's not entirely clear why initially. Oh no, sorry, because I've introduced the third one. Sergio Chang. There's
getting
a
ahead of yourself.
middleman. There's an entrepreneurial middleman, the really successful one in the novel, who actually he is the one who initially adopts almost the young lad, son of a gardener, Liu Jinding, and finesses his way into a better education and then into university and then into it to meet the professor and so on. So there's this shadowy figure, or not so shadowy, he's quite well defined, but it's never quite clear why he's doing it.
If it's about Guanxi, about doing favors to get them back, then he seems to have a lot of confidence in his investments because
Yeah, he must.
he's
He
doing
must
a
break.
lot
He
of
spotted a
favors.
winner. Yeah.
Like I was thinking when he first does a character a favor, I was using my sort of simple Lawai knowledge. Ah, this is Guanxi. He's only helping this young man to get something back later. But then he saves him and bails him out again and again, and you see him doing favors for other higher up figures. And it's like, maybe this is just the guy who likes doing favors. Maybe he's just a
Or
nice
a guy
man.
who likes to feel that he's in control.
Yeah, or a guy
He's
who likes praise from the powerful. But
yeah, he's an odd figure. I mean, they're all actually the most straightforward is probably the you mentioned the other Lidolin, who's this slightly otherworldly professor of agriculture, whose only dream is really to develop a wheat that actually puts out two ears per stalk rather than one, or whatever, I think. And he's kind of he's the I suppose the hero. He's the central character in the book because it all centers around what happened to him at beginning and end. He ends up as the governor who's executed. But he's kind of at the he's an innocent abroad almost, and he's being tossed around at the whim of all these other people, particularly the pairing of Xie Zhichang and Liu Jinding.
I kind of thought going in, just based on the conventions of storytelling and stories I've read and seen in films before, that the master figure, Lidolin, the teacher, he's going to be a corrupting figure, and this younger man, Liu Jinding, will have to make the choices and will either be corrupted or forge his way through. But really, Lidolin is like the conflicted conscience of the novel, and Liu Jinding is like the sort of moral example of the guy you really should not be.
Yeah, although I think the guy you should really not be is Xie Zhichang. Certainly, Lidolin is. I mean, he seems to be spend a lot of time baffled by what's happening to him. He doesn't really understand because it's not. He's not been out to seek any of these honors or whatever. But people keep thrusting them on him and keep taking him out for dinner and so on. But his problem is he just goes along with it. One presumes in the hope that it will allow him finally to get on with the work he really wants to get on with, which it doesn't. Liu Jinding, I find, is he's a very, I'm not he's not a sympathetic character, because he's too much of a chancer, but he's quite an endearing one. But there's this eminence grise in the background pulling all the strings, which is this entrepreneur. Xie Zhichang goes from being a local flower dealer. I thought I was mistranslating when I first came across this flower person, a Huayuan. But this area, the area that the novel is set in, is famous for its for growing ornamental flowers. And this chap starts off as a middleman in the local flower market, and somehow he parlays this up through connections. We have to presume there are lots of other little Liu Jindings wandering around as well, who he's controlling. but he parlays this up into becoming a really high-powered businessman with his finger in all sorts of pies, land development, hotels, the lot. And I suppose that's one of the lessons of this is what was possible in those days from not very much. If you had the will, you could get almost anything with money. But he's certainly the villain of the book, I think.
Right. I was going to compound what you were saying about Liederlin being kind of otherworldly. I think that's a great turn of phrase, because he's from a sort of higher, more rarefied world, academia, and his big mission, I think it's very interesting, this mission that's happening in the 80s, where he's trying to do something that essentially would be serving the people. It's something that would produce a cheap way to double food production, which Absolutely. For a country of huge numbers of largely not very wealthy people is a great solution. And it's not coming from like struggle or ideological strivings.
It's not
or
after scientific glory.
So it's not being done through sort of like traditional 20th century communist means, as in the previous era. He's using science. The 80s is the sort of big return of a focus on, what is it, like science, seriousness, you know, much more objective stuff than political ideology is being used to serve the people. And he's kind of an angelic example of that. But the problem is
he's a very old-fashioned figure. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's a country boy, and his tastes are very simple. His attitude, he says, is very simple. He just wants to get on with his work because he thinks it's going to be of great benefit. And he doesn't understand what's going on around him. I mean, he's a kind of innocent abroad, but it's very one of the tensions. There are a lot of tensions in this book between and you have tensions between the country and the city, between the traditional and the modern. You have tensions between different age groups and so on. It's all about these tensions and the connections that are built within those tensions, and how often it's the tensions that are not catered for. They're unexpected. They're not allowed for. Mm-hmm. Somehow they know they're there, but they don't take, because everyone's in so much of a hurry to keep going and drive forward. They don't stop to look at what's happening and how things are actually underneath the surface falling apart because of the tensions between these different factions or factors.
Right. That my next question was going to be about the morality and moral problems in the story, and I was going to ask you, can it all be boiled down to the private and the personal, as in, like, you know, your personal interests will your private interests will cause you to commit sort of misdeeds in the public with public money or what have you, or your private interests will cause you to do terrible things to the public, to real people, even if they're strangers. But I think that private versus public and so on is just another one of many contradictions that we've just rattled off there. You reminded me, there's a really one of those two contradictions or conflicts, the countryside and the city, plays out in I think it's more or less largely in Liederlin's two marriages, where I think correct me if I'm wrong, but his first one, he marries a sort of someone who's much more urban and sophisticated than him.
And she's the daughter of one of his professors when he at university, yes.
Right, and she's got no time for his country ways. And then I believe it's sort of the reverse that happens in his second marriage. He's become this sort of... He's picked up a lot of the social nuances, and then he ends up with a much more crass wife.
Yeah, who initially brought along as his housekeeper and nanny, because he has a child with his first wife. So the first wife is very much an urban sophisticate, but she's captivated by the Liederlin's by his dedication to his work, and she admires him greatly for that. But that turns out not to be enough. There's a genuinely horrific scene when Liederlin finally he's tried to keep his new wife away from his village, because he knows what they're like and what it's like. But family pressure gets him, and he's forced to go back for a wedding celebration, a wedding feast in his old village, which is obviously very rural, very much out in the sticks. And it ends up with him being taken away to get and getting paralytically drunk, whilst the other young men of the village escort the new wife up to the marriage chamber. And it's not actually a rape, but it's certainly a group grope. She's violated by this group of almost bestial villagers who think this is what they do. This is part of the old country wedding night, and it's quite horrific. And that's basically that is the beginning of the end for their marriage. But it's very dark. But it's also presented as something that is this is the old culture. This is what went on in the villages. This is how we did things. And that's the starkest illustration, I think, of this, of the contrast between town and city, which is a subject you find in many, many novels, of course. But it's a very stark presentation there, and in fact, you feel that the Li Derlin is a genuinely more at home actually in the village overall. I think he's not that comfortable in the urban surroundings.
Yeah, I think it's definitely a pattern I've noticed in pretty much every time I've read a translated Chinese novel by an author from around Li Peifu's generation. If it's set in the countryside, especially if it's somewhere up north, there's going to be moral corruption. The main characters are most likely all going to be kind of men. Many of them will be a bit venal, and probably at least one awful thing will happen to a woman. I mean, I don't want to sound like I'm judging this book. There's nothing wrong with being part of a pattern, but I did sort of recognize it in that pattern. I want to, before, I mean, we already did the characters section, but there's one more character it'd be fun to talk about. He's also facing the contradictions of history. I'm sounding more and more Marxist, not intentional, but he really does. It is a contradiction of history and technology and generations. So he's the detective who's called in to investigate the corruption case, and he's a real pleasure to read, and he jumps in about halfway through.
Yes, he suddenly appears, doesn't he? Yeah, with this odd name, with his double barrel surname and so on. He's an intriguing character. I suppose for our listeners, imagine a kind of Chinese Jack Regan from the Sweeney. Old-fashioned copper.
Yeah, it would be easy for him to come off as a cliche, like this hard as nails, ruthless, morally inflexible guy. But it's, I mean, that is there, but it's written very compellingly, I thought. And then he becomes more 3D when you learn about his relationship with his son. And I thought this is, I mean, you said the book is set in the 80s, but it goes, I guess, through these guys a long, long period in their lives. Because this son is, I'm not entirely sure if we could call him like a streamer, like if he's streaming live video gameplay, but basically
He's a game master, isn't he, really?
He's a e-celebrity of some kind.
Yeah.
Whether it's not like a 2007 style Major League Gamer, or whether it's like a 2016 style video game streamer.
I was
don't
a
know.
Bit confused by that, because you say there seems to be a bit of a time shift there, but I don't know what was going on in China at that time. They may well have been ahead of us in games.
So I know Korea was right in there. Yeah. I don't know about the PRC.
No, well, Korea's crazy. Yes, they were absolutely crazy. Yes. Anyway, but yes, it's a well drawn relationships. You can feel the tensions, and again, it's a bit of it. It's this. There's a lot of incomprehension, I think, here, because we've had Li Derlin not understanding really what's going on around him, and this policeman who's watching his profession change all around him as these slicker juniors come up and get promoted above him, and so on, and also watching his son disappearing into a world which he simply doesn't understand.
Yeah, it's so we start off with a guy from the countryside baffled that his wife doesn't want him to smoke in the house. And then we get a dad baffled that his son has like a gamer girl e-girlfriend.
And is making six times the amount of money he does just from sitting around, as far as he can tell, doing nothing on a computer.
That's an understandable grievance, I think. Yeah. That's the character, as we talked a bit about, but the moral problems. Do you want to dig any more into moral problems, or do we want to sort of summarize the trajectory of the plot?
The thing that strikes me is that I don't think the characters really see. We see moral problems in black and white, pretty much. Whereas in this, you feel that quite a lot of them really don't think they're doing anything wrong. Mm. They don't really have huge moral battles with themselves. They have more practical ones. So it's the practicality of being immoral rather than the immorality of being immoral, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it's often a means to an end. I confess it's been long enough since I read the book. I don't remember a lot of the specific instances of corruption, but a lot of it, from what I remember, is, well, I need to do X, and the only way to do it is off the books or outside the law. Yeah. I'm not hurting anyone. I'm doing favors for my friends. I'm strengthening my relationships. Therefore, it's good for my career. So there's like a lot of, I guess, convenient conflicts of interest.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think we're all guilty of those. But yeah, there you're right. There's a more sort of it's more of a blurred line,
which has always been this case with this whole thing about this word Guanxi connections. It very happily bestrides a whole gamut of levels of back scratching to outright corruption, all of which are essentially just part of how things get done.
Yep. And I guess some listeners might not know, others we're explaining the obvious, but a lot of it is conveyed through food. I think this is not a bad book if you're looking for descriptions of yummy Chinese food.
Yeah, braised noodles, and then there's this extraordinary country feast of the eight delicacies or whatever. Yes.
Yeah, actually, that reminded me. I was a point I didn't quite get to about Li Delin. He's this sort of angelic figure, and I think there's a very, it's maybe you read between the lines to see it, but I think the corrupt sort of figures he meets early on do something very nasty. Perhaps they're not consciously aware they're doing it, but I think they are, and this is a nasty word, I'm using it because I can't think of a better one. I feel like they kind of groom him into becoming a corrupt figure by
doing
a thing. I believe it's like a common pattern in the world of the perpetrator does shocking things to sort of transgress boundaries, to dissolve them and normalize them. So like, I'll take you out for a meal. Well, you don't have to, thanks. Let me get you some things on the menu, and it turns out they're the most expensive ones. Oh, you shouldn't have done that. You really shouldn't have, but I'll eat something to be polite, and it just normalizes.
Just as you were talking, it struck me one of because his favorite dish, is still a humble dish of braised noodles, just noodles and gravy, and he starts off going to the local spit and sawdust restaurant around the corner from where he lives. But as the story progresses, and as Liu Jinding gets his claws deeper into him, they keep eating the same thing. He says, oh, we'll just go out for noodles. But they keep going to more and more expensive restaurants. And these simple braised noodles, they're still braised noodles, but they have more and more expensive ingredients in them. So he's not sort of supposed to notice that how much it's changed, how he's gone from this. He's, in his head, he's still eating braised noodles. But in fact, he's now eating braised noodles with foie gras or whatever. It's this unconscious process.
The best way to multiply the price of a nice bowl of Chinese style beef noodles near Omien is first eat them in a normal hole in the wall place in mainland China, then fly to the UK and try and have an authentic bowl for £15 or £10.
Yeah.
That's a good way
just
to multiply
actually, I
the
just
price.
did that at this lunchtime. There we are.
Yeah, it's paying for memories, I feel like, in my case, getting the authentic stuff. Anyway, before we get lost in that reverie, it's kind of a tragic fall from grace style story. Maybe we don't want to spoil everything, but what would you say about the things that finally sort of do our protagonists, I can't really say heroes, but what does them in? What sort of things? For me, I feel like in Lida Lynn's case anyway, basically all stems from his how he screws up his love life, I think.
Yes, eventually. It's also the fact he just goes along with things. I mean, you get the impression at the end he's really still quite baffled by what's happened to him. But the mechanism of it is his weakness, and because his second wife, who's this crude country girl who comes as his nanny, turns out to be sexually quite voracious, and he obviously rather likes that. There's some very odd stuff around that. But so, yes, it's his appetites, perhaps, are what betray him, because his baser appetites, his idealism and his scientific work is not balanced by any kind of really any restraint in his personal life.
I think if you're raised to be nice and gentle, you have hard lessons to learn that you can be nice and passive for so long, but then eventually being passive will cause you to be, you know, irresponsible and get yourself and others in trouble. And being passive is no basis for a good relationship, if a relationship is indeed what you want.
And that's his problem. He is essentially he's not proactive in anything except his own work. So yeah, so that's his downfall. The Liu Jinding, one of I was particularly pleased when I came up with the title for this translation, because it's a three-way pun on, because you have graft meaning hard work, because some of them get where they are through hard work. You've got graft meaning corruption, but actually topping and tailing the book is the process that Liu Jinding's master gardener father undertakes of creating the perfect flowering plum bonsai tree. And that involves grafting, collecting a root bowl from deep in the Sichuan Mountains, and then finding the right growing stock to graft onto it. So the graft, you get the whole story of this magical plant, which is, you know, his masterwork, and it's bonsai, which is, people should know, a Chinese craft, not a Japanese one. And in fact, the word bonsai is the Japanese pronunciation of the Chinese bonsai. But it's, you know, phenomenally valuable things. So this humble gardener's skill in creating bonsai is a pure thing, and it's perhaps the real value, which itself eventually gets subverted, because this magical masterwork that's created, Liu Jinding has his eye on it, thinking, this is, you know, when I really need to bribe somebody, when the crunch comes and I've got to come up with the ultimate bribe, this bonsai tree is going to be my ace in the hole. It's what I'm going to be able to produce, because no one else will ever have anything like it. But supposedly the master gardener has refined it so he can actually control when it flowers. So it's the perfect tree. But at the end of the book, Liu Jinding finally turns to this to try and kind of buy his way out of trouble. And it fails. So this perfect creation, when it's used for a corrupt purpose, doesn't allow itself to be used like that, and it fails, and it ends up on a rubbish heap. And so in that respect, if you're looking for a moral, you can say that graft doesn't work. You know, it doesn't pay off. It in the end, it fails. And in fact, in this book, everyone who's involved in these various layers of corruption comes to a bad end of one kind or another. So I suppose it's a morality tale as well. But I particularly like the elegance of the graft thing of this bonsai tree being lovingly created, and then when it's misused, it refuses to play ball.
Yeah, there's some kind of clever response here about losing sight of the trees for the forest. Yeah,
wood for trees or whatever. No, I think you'll have to work quite hard at that, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I already did this first time around when we had a conversation like this for a Sinoist Books event for this book, But just again, it is genuinely a great title. It's not a translation of the Chinese title. It has it's got threefold significance in only five letters, and it's one sharp, snappy syllable, graft, which I guess is great news for the book cover designer. You know, that's great, doesn't it? They don't have to.
Yeah, that was, I think, this was Sinoist Books' first venture into kind of high art. The woodcut, they specially commissioned an artist to do the woodcuts, the multi-layer woodcuts, and I think it's absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, I think it is maybe their best cover. It's very nice.
Interestingly, the main reason we had to, because we had some completely absurd discussions over the title of this book, because the Chinese title is completely untranslatable.
Pingyuan Ke, is that right?
Pingyuan Ke. Yeah, Pingyuan is fine. That's the term for the Central Plains, the Yellow River Valley, the sort of the China's breadbasket. But the word Ke is untranslatable here because I'm not really, and even when Chinese colleagues, when consulted, weren't really quite sure what it meant. They could see what the title meant, but they couldn't quite tell you what this word "ke" meant. It's like it can be a guest, it can be also things like, but it's not. And then it baffled us how to translate it. So we had to start casting around, and eventually, happily, settled on graft. But it's one of these you come across occasionally, well, not actually even just that occasionally, Chinese things that you simply can't translate. And actually things that the Chinese, I'm sure there are things in English that we know exactly what it means, but we can't explain why it means that or how it's come to mean that or exactly all the nuances of it. And I think this, the original title, Pingyuan Ke, is one of those. Yeah, you know exactly what it means, Pat, if you're Chinese, when you see the title, but you can't explain it.
Yeah, it has like multiple meanings that sort of do overlap but don't in like a hard, intraceable, rhizomatic sort of way. Am I misremembering that it means something like kind of like a mensch, like a solid kind of figure as well as a guest, or have I totally complicated that inside my own head?
No, you may be right. You may be right. I'm trying to remember back to when to all the researchers we did and how.
There'll be some very literate Chinese speaker screaming and screaming at their phone right now,
saying, "Yeah, you ignorant fools! Of course it is." Yes.
Yeah, for sure. And to that listener, hello. You are seen. You are
thank
heard.
You for your contribution.
I was hoping we'd get to that title. That was a very interesting thing to learn. My next section in these set of questions was going to be about justice. I was going to introduce the cop. We already did. But I was also going to ask if they're victimless crimes. But before I ask that, I thought we could talk about another sort of thematic character-related thing that I found pretty engaging in this book. And I think I've seen it done quite engagingly in other similar books as well. It's the way the characters wrestle with their guilt, how they are able to like deny it, how they are physically and sort of spiritually fly, you know, run away from the guilt, and how when they face it, it really crushes them. And
yeah, I think because we were saying earlier on that they don't really see that they're doing anything wrong
until they do.
The cumulative effects suddenly come home to them, you know, with most of all on Li Dolin, who really doesn't have that much idea he's done anything terribly wrong.
Yeah.
I think the others, I think that they all know their chances. I think Liu Jinding knows he's a chancer, but he thinks he's a good one and he's going to get away with it.
Yeah. I remember we have a scene where Liu Jinding, he goes back home. And like, I think if I remember right, he has a bit of like a spate of madness where he feels like, is it like a ghost is pursuing him or something?
Yes, when I think he's feverish.
Right.
And he's going back to hide out because they're after him. He's been found out through some complex detective work involving mobile phone cards that I didn't entirely follow myself. But he's fled back to his village, and he's obviously running a fever, I think, and he's going to hide out in his grandfather's old potting shed, his father's old potting shed. And there is this sequence of, and when he's running across the fields, when he's being feels he's being pursued by, I can't think who it is now, but yes, it's a sort of nightmare sequence. Quite well, rather well written, I think.
Yeah. I'm struggling to think of really specific stuff from the book, but I remember thinking that, yeah, the sort of cavernous feeling of guilt is striking. And I might be mixing this up with other books, but I feel like in Chinese lit I've read where a character sort of faces what they've done and what they've done to other people and what they've made of their life. I don't know if it's said explicitly, but I feel like it's an acknowledgement that, oh yeah, I'm a mortal man. It's usually a man, isn't it? I'm a mortal man. I am not untouchable. I'm completely touchable. I'm going to die one day, possibly very soon, if I get executed by my government. This is all my life is, and I've turned it into a great big hole that I'm about to fall down, and I'm terrified, and I'm ashamed, and I'm sad. It's and I feel like it. I maybe this says something about how I feel about my own mortality. But like a few times reading Chinese lit, and this book's one of them. That hits me indirectly through these corrupt characters. Like, fucking hell, this is all there is, and this is what I've done with it. This is not good.
Oh well, I think I've got too old for that now. I think that might be a luxury of youth, perhaps. You'll become more sanguine about it later on.
That's good. Yeah, I was kind of banking on that, but.
Yeah, I mean, we know we all go through a period when we like to beat ourselves up, but then you discover that A, it's quite painful, and B, it doesn't get you anywhere. So,
Yeah, no, that's sort of where I'm at now.
so I just turned up that bit in the book, and it, yeah, as an extended nightmare, it is almost a nightmare. Speaking ghost walls and black ghost, green ghost fire and black demons and things. Yeah, very powerful. Little bit. Sorry, I just had to remind myself of it because
Oh, no.
actually, there's an awful lot goes on in this book. When I was sort of thinking, trying to get getting ready for this interview, and I thought, well, I better make sure I know everything that happens, and I've got the main bits right. But there's an awful lot of little subplots and other sub stories and so on. He really packs it in.
Yeah, and it's not doesn't feel like an epic either. I'm not sure what the word count comes to, but it's not it didn't feel flabby to me. It didn't feel like uber condensed or short, but
No,
it
I don't
yeah.
think he. I don't think he overindulges. I can. T I was going to say I can tell you the character count, but oh, never mind. It wasn't one. I think it must have been about 250,000 characters, something like that.
Right. So that's some thoughts on guilt and running away from it or not. But also it's, corruption is not a strictly personal affair. It has effects on people and society. And I'll confess, I don't remember who the sort of victims of the crimes are, besides from like the public purse, with the exception of one person who winds up dead. But can you refresh my memory, like are we told sort of like who in the public is getting screwed over by these dodgy deals? Like I know in the real China of I don't know about the present day, but certainly I believe this was a big one in the 90s and the noughties. Pollution, a lot of pollution came down to corruption because you would skimp on environmental protections. Money would change hands, the economy would keep growing, but the environment suffers. And the people who have to breathe the air and drink the water suffer.
I don't think there's anything too specific, except there is the one episode of there's a big demonstration. This is when
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
and I'm trying that's over land deals, I think. If in doubt, it's probably over land deals.
Right.
So yes, I'm sure it is. That's right. And a promised development of a site that was going to benefit all the local residents, and it never happens, or it happens in another way, and they all get screwed out of their property, and then there's a big protest, and they're going to block the main railway line and so on. But it gets dispersed by the threat of using firearms, I think. The police. It's not. I don't think it's. Is it Heilongjiang China is actually, it kind of bluffs, or is bluffed into threatening to use firearms. And then also there's a fake arrest, in
Oh
which
yes.
the supposed the crooked land agent or whatever is actually taken away, but it's all a bluff and so on. So
Gutter.
yes, I mean there aren't many. I think that's the main example where you actually see who is being harmed by this corruption. But at the same time, there are winners there as well, because some of the I think they're bribed to go and make false statements as well. So some people come out of it quids in because they've actually played along with the corruption, whereas other the so it's very mixed messaging there. And it's not a moralistic tale. It's more of an observation, I think. We don't know what the author thinks that clearly. I don't think he's saying, look, this is what's going on, this is how it's going on, make up your own minds. I think I don't think you have any morality thrust down your throat in it.
No, yeah, there's no magical solution presented. And it just feels like it's a piece of fiction that is inspired by real events, follows a sort of realist principle of not veering into a fantasy that satisfies the reader and doesn't prioritize representing the world. It's just sort of a dramatization of real things that went on over the decades.
Yeah.
I mean, you can read it as a moral.
Although
tale.
You kind of feel you're being invited to pass judgment.
Yeah, 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 for sure. It's not that's not there and that reading's not available. It's just that it's not doesn't go out of its way to tell you who's the goodie, or even like at what point Vida Lynn could have gone down a different path. It's not a fable. Yeah. So my next set of questions, I'm trying to go along at the same sort of clip that Li Peifu did here. next set of questions was about translation. We already discussed the title. I was just wondering, just your work as the translator, how did translating this book compare language-wise, difficulty-wise, experience-wise versus other books you've translated?
It was more straightforward than some of the historical novels I've done, but that's and they because they tend to be quite literary, as it were. People show. Yeah. So it flowed quite smoothly. I enjoyed translating it. There were some I may have missed this, the problem. One of the big problems translating contemporary novels is when they're set in the countryside and you have sort of bits of dialects and things thrown in. What can you do with that? And there is quite a lot of discussion of, particularly of vulgarities. English is such a poor language. When you want to be rude or vulgar or obscene in English, you're really quite limited in your choice. Whereas Chinese is much more flexible and has many more interesting things, which you simply can't. If you translate them literally into English, they just sound ridiculous or nonsensical, and so you're reduced to using a few. Well-worn words and phrases, and I don't like the idea of I can't see any way of as it were translating dialect convincingly.
Yeah, I was going to say probably a lot of the richest curses in English come from regional dialects.
Yeah.
Like I'm from Scotland, there are some there's plenty of good, nasty things to call someone.
I think you're much richer, and the Irish as well, much richer than we are in those.
Sure, but like English regions as well, like Cockneys, Scousers.
Yeah,
I'm sure they've got plenty of mean things, but they're going to sound very weird coming out of a Chinese.
That's the problem. You can't say, oh well, let's try. They're what's the equivalent of this? They're sort of broad yokel types. So let's make them West Country. And start throwing West Country phrases in because it would just sound stupid.
Yeah,
so,
and you're throwing the West Country people under the bus as well.
Yeah. So that's always a bit of a challenge, and I think in translation it loses a bit of the richness of the original text there, because all I can do is sort of coarsen my language slightly and so on, but it's never going to have the full flavour, which is slightly frustrating because it would be nice if it did. And I'm sure that I miss bits. There are nuances in there that I don't get and should. But overall, it was a pleasure to translate. Actually, he writes very patronizing. He writes very nicely. He writes well and fluently. And nothing brought me up short thinking, how am I going to make that sound good in English or whatever. So, which is always a good sign. You know, it flows, because if the thought flows. It doesn't matter what language it is, as it were. You're going to be able if it's coherent and so on in its original language, you're going to be able to make it coherent and flowing in the target language. It's where you get, I'm naming no names. The novel I'm currently translating, which has actually been turned into a TV soap opera and a film, and it's very much seems to be written. It's a screenwriter writing, and it's much harder to translate it well, because again, reading in English, Linda LaPlante, for instance, writes brilliant TV series, but her novels are terrible. The English is, it doesn't work. It works brilliantly for screenplays and so on, but actually as novels it doesn't. And it's the same with that, and it's very difficult to take something that doesn't flow well in its original language and make it into something that does flow well in English. Whereas Graft, Lipe, there was no such problem. It was a pleasure to translate.
Yeah, this is not a point about the book or about Chinese lit, but an observation, I guess, as a writer and an editor, about spoken language. The dialogue in a book, you know, written in prose, wouldn't work if you transplanted it one for one to a TV show.
No.
Like you said, TV dialogue in a book would be not a good book. And if you directly take the words we speak and try and put them on the page, they're an absolute mess. I've been working on a transcript. Actually, I had two interns who were volunteering sort of part-time over February on the podcast, and they both produced a transcript, and I've been sort of tidying up one of the drafts recently. And I've realized if I want this transcript to be good, I have something like the translator's dilemma. I can make it true to how I actually said the sentences and have it be terrible English, or I can adapt it so that it stops being a great transcript but becomes more beautiful English. So yeah, these things are always, I can't speak for a translator's perspective. I feel like you can think of it as the way language works, conspiring against you and always never being perfectible, or you can just think of it as a gift, as a way to make the sentences beautiful and hone them even more.
It strikes me whenever I'm writing translating dialogue and I look at it in English, I think, well, yeah, that's not a bad translation, but actually, as you say, no one would ever say that.
Yeah,
you try saying that in a conversation and just, you know, it would sound, it just doesn't sound right. So you're right, you can't actually reproduce, well, you can, I mean, obviously you can reproduce spoken word in writing, but it for it to read well, you have to compromise.
Yeah. Going on another tangent, I don't know if you heard about there was a TV show, I think it was a Netflix show, Wednesday, all about the character Wednesday Adams from the Adams family. I didn't watch it, my girlfriend did, but I saw a very funny article where the star of the show, the young woman playing the girl Wednesday, decided to just act like a spoiled Hollywood star and refused to speak a lot of the lines as they were written in the script, because a lot of it was, I guess, corny. And she would just stop, look at the director, the producer, and say, "No one talks like this. My character wouldn't talk like this. I'm going to make it more natural and more normal." Because, yeah, it's just the principle of no one talks like this. This is stupid.
Yeah.
Hold on a minute. Like, that's not a bad principle to...
No, I mean, good for her, I would say.
Yeah.
If she could make it work.
Mm-hmm. Right, so our final question in this translation section, it's really a freestyle one. I just wanted to ask you, since you've got a lot of translation and education around Chinese, all things Chinese culturally under your belt, do you have a personal perspective on the craft and the business of translating Chinese literature?
it's a very apposite question, because I'm going to have to start thinking about it properly. I'm going out, thankfully, to China in May. It's been 3 years not going there, having been going sort of twice a year. And I'd set up my own trip, and then... kind of word got out, and I've now been asked to do two lectures when I'm out there in Xi'an. Regarding actually precisely that, I think, which means I'm going to have to try and quantify and my attitude, because actually I am the least academic of translators. I don't have any theories about how you should go about translating, what you're doing when you're translating. I just do it because I like it. And I love it, actually. I mean, I've been translating things since I was at school. So it's very nice. It's nice when you get paid for something you like doing. But I've been lucky to be mostly to be offered novels that I think have something to say about China, the country, and China, the people, to an audience that misunderstands a lot of the where there are a lot of misunderstandings. So my only aim is to be as faithful as I can to how I read the original. Now, you can see I have no idea, because I'm a Westerner and I'm not a native speaker. I don't know whether I'm actually reading these texts correctly, or am I understanding them the way a native reader would understand. So, but what I strive to do is get as close to what I feel the flavor of the original is. And that's basically it. Translating Chinese it's an odd business, translating Chinese. You know, I sit there because I chunk up my text and I'll translate a chunk, I'll have the Chinese text above and then I'll have my translation underneath. And I'll sometimes just sit there for a minute and stare at it and think, how on earth did I get that out of that? you know, it just looks so unlikely. And my part is to provide that, the catalyst that transforms one into the other, to the best of my ability. And it's often, I find the way character, I've had an increase in, as the longer you spend with characters, the more kind of hypnotic they become. But I find that in the end, you're not translating, you're certainly not translating character by character. Characters create pictures, I think, in your head in a way that words don't. And I will then have a picture in my head of what this particular sentence also is saying, and then I have to describe that picture. I mean, it's not quite like that, but it's there's more of an interpretive process involved with Chinese than with any other translation, which is why you have to be very careful. But it's also what makes it so entertaining and so enthralling to do. But no, I can't imagine treating translating as an academic subject. I think it's a craft. Right. And the more you try and dissect it, the less faithful you'll be to the original. So you have to let the texts talk to you, I think, is all I say.
Yeah, you could say if you try to instrumentalize it too practically for your own benefit, it will wither and die, not unlike a grafted plant.
Very good. Yes, but yes. No, it will. You can't force it. And you can't make it into something it isn't, and so on. It's but it's, you know, I'm obsessive. I just sit happily all day translating away. And sometimes I get frustrated and so on, but overall it's just because it engages so many different aspects of your both your intellectual abilities and your creativity. If you have the kind of verbal mind, I think it's as important how good your English is as how good your Chinese is when you're translating. But you get wrapped up in it. Interestingly, my wife has just started working as an editor for Sinoist as well.
All right.
She doesn't have any Chinese, but she's read some of my books and so on. But she's now got completely caught up in it as well. And so we'll have the house at the moment. We'll have me downstairs translating, and she's upstairs editing away. But you don't. You get swept up into it, I think, and in a way that's quite hard to explain. But it's. I mean, I think it's a huge privilege to be given the chance to do this. And so you have a duty to get it as right as you can, and that means drawing on lots of different aspects of your own experience, particularly, I mean, not just linguistic. I mean, I as a younger person, I read voraciously, but a lot of it was crap. I don't go for the highbrow greatly, but you learn a lot from reading both bad literature or stuff that is dismissed as popular fiction, which in fact is actually really good writing. And that's that being having that kind of background to draw on as well. I think that's what's so satisfying about it is the chance it gives you to draw on so many different aspects of things.
Absolutely. This podcast is very pro middle brow.
Excellent.
The meaty middle, for sure. What you said about the sorts of the transfiguration side of translation, at least from Chinese to English, where like it's kind of hard to say how the characters go through the magical black box and come out as a Latin alphabet language. And that you were saying that your sort of black box in the middle there is your ability to create the mental images. There's a thing I heard about recently, I think through podcasts, a condition called aphantasia, which is the inability to voluntarily create a mental picture in your head. People with aphantasia can't picture a scene, person, or an object, even if it's very familiar. And I feel like even just trying to imagine what that's like is a sort of an insight into how do we write? How do we how do we do anything creative?
And what we take for granted. And so, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's left when you take that away? And you know, people who have aphantasia are more or less normal people, but presumably they go through certain mental challenges that bit differently, or that much differently from other people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a bizarre thought.
Yeah. And there's a whole other different podcast we could use to talk about that. But instead, I'll take us to the miscellaneous section. First miscellaneous question for you. Could you suggest a Chinese word of the day for this episode?
Yes, I was trying to think of that. And oddly enough, a character which isn't necessarily directly related. And I'm just desperately trying to remember which tone it is now. Xiu, fourth tone, meaning refined or elegant, or tan, which and the character it's an odd looking character, and its form is on the top is the five stroke character for grain, and on the bottom is the second half of nionai denai, milk. So you've got grain and milk, because apparently the original meaning of this character was to put forth shoots, to grow, to blossom, so on. And the idea is it's a stalk which is then producing something that is nutritious in milk. At least that's one derivation going back to seal forms. But then it's more common usage is this something being refined and elegant and you know, at the top of its game kind of thing. And but I thought that the growing bit, the fact that something that is behaving, that is doing what it comes naturally to it, this thing that's growing, a plant putting out flowers, or a stem of wheat putting forth its grain, the meaning somehow transferred. That's something that is right and proper and beautiful in itself, and so that becomes the kind of extended meaning, and it goes back to the plants and Li Derlin's obsession with grain. And making grain produce, it's that the two elements of that character seem to encapsulate what he's after, and it just happens. I've kept coming across that character in things I'm translating recently, so it sprang to mind. It's an odd looking character. It's not a particularly elegant one, which is odd because it should be with that meaning. It's another thing. It's not an elegant character at all. It looks a bit unbalanced, I think. But there you are. So there's a thought for you. Xiu.
That's amazing. I'm going to see if I've found the right one here. Thinking I'm 50-50, I've got it right or wrong. Can you see this character?
Hang on, let me just open it up. That's the one.
Ah, yeah. Brilliant, got it right.
Look at that.
Magical.
It does look a bit like a plant as well. Anyway, it's rather fun. And it's characters. I mean, characters are one of the great, your most best friends when you're trying to teach kids Chinese, because they love characters and so on, and then telling stories around them.
Right. Yeah.
So anyway, so there we are. I think that's quite a good choice.
Sure. And while you were thinking of it, I looked up how to say aphantasia. Apparently it's, and I'm going to slaughter the tones, but it's Huan Zhe Zheng. And I've got it in traditional.
I was taught in traditional.
Right.
I'm that old.
It's Huan as in like Ke Huan, or like fantasy or fiction. Zhue, I think, is in Zhue De. I'm not sure.
Dread
It's
and
got
feelings to feel. Yeah.
it's got the it's the bot the
The
bottom is
bottom's.
the like it looks like the jian to
Yeah,
see.
jet, yeah.
Yeah, and Jung I don't recognize. I don't know why I'm describing it. I can just send it you. yeah, that's a Fantasia anyway.
Did
Boink.
you send it? Oh, there we are. Okay, Jiajun. Okay, so the yes, that's the disease radical. Yes, okay.
Ah, right, okay. That would make
But the
sense.
last bit, yeah, jump. Yeah.
The more you know. I'm probably gonna forget that before I go to sleep tonight. Anyway, next miscellaneous question. It's a piece of music you'd pair with the story. So let's say they're going to make a Graft, a movie. What would you pick for a significant part of the soundtrack?
Now, I thought and thought about this, and I didn't come up with anything, mainly because I have very bizarre taste in music.
Well, that's fine. You're not alone.
So no, I couldn't. I'm afraid that I'll try and think of something still, Rose. I spent a good half hour trying to think what would I pair with this. I mean, no, I don't know. I just don't know. No, I can't. I if I have a brilliant idea, I'll let you know. But I no.
Okay, no worries. I had one and then I forgot it and I remembered it again and th I thought of another one in between. The one I originally thought of, it was going to be something from the album Undone by the Roots. They're a hip hop group whose, I guess, kind of gimmick is that they're all of their beat that goes that the rap goes on top of is made by studio instruments rather than like produced beats. And as they've gone on, they've become more and more artistically ambitious. Undone is an album, a concept like a you know like a. Like a prog rock band from the 70s, they did a concept album, so that sort of tells a story. And it's the story of a guy who rises from like the hood somewhere in the States and throws his morals out the window and rises to wealth and experiences all the pleasures of the world, but you know, near the end of his life, feels hollow and I think dies. And we get some of the stories are from the perspective of the afterlife. Looking back, so it's very existential. And I was trying to pick like which track from that would be a good fit for Graft. I think the one I picked was Make My.
I did it all for the money, Lord. That's what it seems. Well, in the world of night terrors, it's hard to dream. They howling cash rules everything. Let's call it cream, cause when it rises to the top, you get the finer things. Ocean fronts rolling blunts with model chicken saying grace over lobster steak. Like, please forgive us for riding business with camera plates. Too busy looking backwards for jackers to pump my brakes. For help sign to symbolize the lie that hunger takes. Addicted to the green, if I don't ball, I get the shakes. I give it all for a peace of mind, for heaven's sakes. My heart's so heavy that the ropes that hold my casket breaks. Cause everything that wasn't for me, I had to chase.
They told me that the ends won't justify the means. And he told me at the end, it won't justify the dreams that I've had since a child. Maybe I'll throw it.
So I'm going to say it's make my it's the full line in the lyrics is make my departure from the world. So I'd be putting this near the end when one of the characters is sentenced to death for their crimes and is staring down the barrel. And then the other one I thought of was a bit more, I don't know, also a hip hop track actually. I guess hip hop is the modern genre for like the highs and lows of debauchery. It's
Yeah, certainly its exponents would suggest that, yes.
yeah, in its current iteration anyway. So the track is Swimming Pools. It's by Kendrick Lamar.
Then somebody said to me, nigga, why you babysitting? Only two or three shots. I'ma show you how to turn it up a notch. First you get a swimming pool full of liquor, then you dive in it. Pool full of liquor, then you dive in it. I wave a few bottles, then I watch them all fly. All the girls wanna play, may watch. I got a swimming pool full of liquor and they dive in it. Pool full of liquor, I'ma dive in it.
Pour.
Drink.
Headshot.
Drink.
Sit down.
Drink.
I think it's, I had a look at the lyrics. I think it's sort of largely about alcoholism. It's about a guy at a party whose way of coming to enjoy the party is just by knocking back one shot after another of vodka. The main hook is you get a swimming pool of liquor and you full of liquor and you dive in. But I think if you sort of take the metaphor for like the only way to go is to fall in deeper, that's a fit for
just keep swimming, as it were. Yeah,
keep swimming, keep diving deeper, keep descending, and enjoy whatever pleasures it brings you until the proverbial liver failure.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
I just, as you were talking, I can offer you an ironic one from another generation.
Excellent.
Which would be John Denver's Country Roads.
Okay. Country Roads, take me home.
You've frozen on it. Still there. To the place.
Yes, I'm still here.
Yeah, no, yes. So the country road, take me home to the place that I belong. Unfortunately, it's in West Virginia. But it's this kind of trying to get back to an ideal that doesn't really exist. Because that's you know, because the Ojin Ding ends up running back home. Oh,
yeah.
Actually, there's another song like that. Anyway, yes, never mind. Got me thinking now, but no, I haven't really got one.
Okay, no worries. Right, there's our tracks. Listeners will have been able to enjoy little clips of those. Final miscellaneous question, the bonus question. So these are ones I strip out and upload to the show's Patreon. So listeners listening to the main episode, you're just going to hear after I've asked the question. If you want to hear the question, it will be going up to the Patreon, patreon.com/TrChFic, TrChFic. So the question for you, James, is this. How would you compare depictions of corruption in modern Chinese lit with other depictions that you've come across, be it in film, in literature from other places? Do you think the Chinese has a special quality, or do you see parallels? I think I can wrap up the bonus question just there and take us to the further reading questions, the final phases of the interview. So if listeners want more like Graft, where would you point them?
Well, if they can hang on, I don't know, except for the two books that the one book I finished translating, which was Zhang Ping's Jiezi Choice, which I think was made into a film or two films even. Which is very much a similar. It's one man's stand. It's an honest man taking a stand against corruption, which he discovers is in fact all around him and into his family, including his wife. But that's not published yet. But it will be. I think it's going through the editorial stage at the moment. But you can find the film. If I can't remember what the film. Well, I think the film is simply called Jiezi, the Choice. And I think you can find it on some streaming services. The other one, the one that I'm working on at the moment, which is called Zhenmin de Caichan, The Property of the People, which is part of a two-part series by Joe Mason. And the first part was In the Name of the People, I think, which has been translated by someone else. And then there's the Property of the People. And this, I would recommend actually watching. You can get it on Netflix. You can find the sort of 36 episode soap opera, a television miniseries, not so many actually. And it's called Breakout in Chinese, but I think if you search People's Property, you'll find it. And that's actually quite entertaining. And again, it gives you a look into the scale of this thing and the complexities and so on. But in terms of other literature, I'm afraid I can't point you anywhere.
That's fair enough. Yeah, I was going to say, again, I'm not sure how much corruption fiction I've read that I have that I can think of would all be mostly by Chinese writers of this generation. And I think I would say to listeners, if you read Graft and you want kind of more of corruption in the Northern Plains by a certain type of guy, and you want a bigger serving, a longer book that you can sort of get lost in, Empires of Dust, Diguo is, you know, it's a nice case of similar but not the same.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
It's a slower burn, I suppose, but you have a guy from humble beginnings who gets wrapped up in both business and government in reform era China. But it's a very different, I guess it's more of a personal journey, and it felt more countryside to me. It felt much less infected by urban influences and how urban sophistication can feed into corruption and whatnot. But yeah, I think that's an interesting sibling text from the same, available in translation from the same publisher. It's an older book, I guess. That's a difference.
Yes, I don't know when that was written, because Graft was only written in 2000 and first published in 2017, I think.
Right, yeah. So Graft is fairly recent, really.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's published in the original Chinese, we mean.
Graft came out in 2022, yeah.
Right. Yeah, so that's about all we can do for that question. I'll ask you what you're reading just now for a final question.
Interesting. I don't actually, because I spend all my day staring at text on screen, I tend not to do so much reading now, but I do a lot of listening, especially about walking the dog. I have audiobooks going all the time, and I get through. And the one I've just finished, and actually I suppose in some ways it's quite relevant, is Rong Chang's biography of the Empress Dowager. You know, Rong Chang was the author of Wild Swans, which she's best known for, but she with her husband John Halliday wrote a biography of Mao. I won't talk about that too much, but there aren't many serious works on Empress Cixi, who's probably one of the most important figures certainly in the last 200 years of Chinese history, if not in the last 500 or 1,000 years. She's an extraordinary woman, and particularly relevant because she came to power, as it were, at a time when Western influences first really began to make themselves felt in a seriously harmful way in China, and all sorts of internal pressures as well. It's a fantastically researched book. Some of the conclusions that are drawn wouldn't necessarily agree with, but Cixi became a great hate figure in the West, and you know she was sort of the model of this evil Chinese woman, and there were cartoons of her. One great field of research is cartoons, Western cartoons of China in the late 19th century.
Oh,
and
dear.
The depictions are dreadful, really awful. And she was, in fact, an extraordinary woman and deserves rehabilitation. The Chinese demonized her, the communists early on demonized her as well as the sort of final expression of the corrupt imperial regime. But she's being gradually rehabilitated, and her place in Chinese history in preserving the integrity of China when the West was intent on carving it up can't be overestimated. So that's I'd recommend it. It's a bloody long book, I have to say. So not great for carrying around, but very good in audio form. But I mean, equally good reading and well illustrated, and as I say, phenomenally well researched. So that's that. Not great literature, but fascinating subject. Otherwise, I say my fiction reading stroke listening is determinedly lowbrow.
If listeners want a real trip, just try entering these three words into Google image search: Empress Cixi, that's Cixi, cartoon, and there's a whole spectrum.
It's quite extraordinary, some of them. There's an extraordinary one from a New York paper or from an American paper in which her face is superimposed on that of a notorious female murderess called Mrs. Knack, I believe. Mrs. Knack.
The Google search,
a picture of her with sort of blood dripping from her fingernails and slaughtering with heads on spikes. And so it's quite extraordinary.
I think I'm seeing that New York one. Yes. So the Google image search, I won't spoil it completely, but it does turn up some of those turn of the 19th into 20th century cartoons. But then there's modern culture in there as well. There's like some kind of American looking like kids TV cartoon. There's a how could I say this? Creepy sexualized like anime girl. So there's a Reddit little cartoon character dressed up as Sushi. It's all there.
And you'll also probably find the still from of Dame Flora Robson playing Sissy in 54 Days in Peking.
Probably in there somewhere.
With Charlton Heston as the noble American savior. And so it's all about that's about the Boxer Uprising.
Right. The cumulative output of humankind as filtered through Google, always a wild ride. I'll just to close this off, I'll mention what I'm reading, which is actually nothing because I finished the book I was reading, Roland Barthes' Mythologies, yesterday or 2 days ago. And all I've read between then is, I think, one academic article. It was an overview of the translator Howard Goldblatt's output. So I'm now probably going to download the next book to my Kindle I'm going to read, and it's going to be one I'll be covering on the show. Columbia University Press sent me a novel in translation called Puppet Flower, a novel of 1867 Formosa, a historical novel set in Taiwan. So they sent me this thing quite a while ago, you know, with the understanding I'd you know, cover it on the show. So I feel like I'm paying off a little bit of that debt now, at least talking about it at the end of this episode. But that is forthcoming. That'll be in the queue at some point once I've read it. Anyway, that's what I'm going to be reading, and that's about it for our chat. Anything you want to fire off, James, before I say thank you?
No, I think you've probably heard more than enough of my voice by now anyway. But no, it's been a thoroughly enjoyable experience. It's always nice to talk about these things to people who know what you're talking about. It's not always the experience you have.
I'm very aware that time only moves forwards, and I haven't been back to China since I last left. So I'm glad that reading the fiction is compensating to some extent for actually being there.
Well, get there. That's the only thing. Get there. Uh-huh.
One day. Yes, one day. Anyway, thank you very much, James. I'll end our call, or I'll end our interview by hitting the record button again. But yeah, thanks. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you. That's been a pleasure.
Lovely. And we have come to the end of the show. So once again, huge thank you to James for coming on and talking about this very interesting book. I say it every time. And I say that I say it every time. But yeah, it was a great discussion. And this was a book I genuinely enjoyed reading quite a lot. Now, if you genuinely enjoy this podcast, then perhaps you'd like to consider materially supporting it. It does cost me money every month to cover the hosting fees, and it does take up quite a lot of my time as well. And you can get something wonderful in return if you support the show via Patreon. If you go to patreon.com/TrChFic, TrChFic, there are over 100, I'm going to say it's sitting around 130 or something now, bonus episodes. Some are short little bonus answers. Others are me kind of going off solo for up to 30, sometimes even 40 minutes, sometimes just 15, about a book that I've read or I'm reading. Could be nonfiction, could be something about China but written in English, or it could be the golden standard, the translated Chinese fiction. All sorts of stuff is up there, and you can get it for minimum one, I forget if it's £1 or $1, but anyway, there's various tiers, but the lowest one gets you everything because, you know, I'm not fancy enough to have lots of clever different content layers. If you want to just sign up temporarily as well, like if you want to sign up for 1 or 2 months, download everything and then flee the scene, you know what, I won't be mad. And even if I was mad, I don't really have the means to stop you. So that's an option. If you'd rather not sign up as a subscriber, if that sort of thing stresses you out like it does me, you can also make a one-off contribution via Buy Me a Coffee. Links to both Patreon and Buy Me a Coffee are up on the TrChFic homepage at trchfic.com. Just click support and you'll see the two magic buttons there. Okay, money, begging for money aside, what's the best thing you can do for the show? Well, if you've been listening for a long time and you don't skip these outros, you'll know the best thing you can do, IMO, is to spread the word. So tell your friends, tell your family, tell your lausche, your teacher, whoever the sort of James Trapp educator figure is in your life, and do please tell the mentor who is teaching you the ways of corruption, the Darth Sidious to your Darth Vader, and I don't know if I can use Obi-Wan and Anakin again, because Obi-Wan's a good guy, but you know, the Obi-Wan to your Anakin, but in terms of generating Guanxi in order to get rich and screw over the people. Yeah, but that's it. We're done serving the people. We're now screwing over the people on this show. And on that sinister note, Zaijian.